Welcome, Dr. Patricia Turner. Dr. Turner is Director of Membership Services for the American College of Surgeons and has been an integral part of the ACS COVID-19 communications team, as well as, of course, year-round of all of Membership Services. Welcome, Dr. Turner.
Thanks so much.
I'd like to speak with you for a few minutes about some of the wellness initiatives. But before we get to wellness initiatives, perhaps you could just give us an idea of the activities of the membership services on an ongoing basis. So let's say pre-COVID-19.
Well, the Division of Member Services is the division that works most directly, perhaps, with the rank and file members of the ACS. So under the umbrella of member services are a number of ways that members interact with us, including our chapters, both domestic and international, the advisory councils. There are 14 of them representing all of the specialties in the House of Surgery, because the ACS is, in fact, an organization that represents every surgical specialty. The Board of Governors, which represent, again, the rank and file by virtue of where they live or what their specialty is or what subspecialties to which they belong. And then the demographic groups, the women in surgery have a committee, the Committee on Diversity, the Resident and Associate Society, medical students, young fellows, the military. So there are a number of different constituent groups to which you can belong if you're a fellow of the college. And much of that, along with things like dues and billing and the interview process, becoming a member, all of that is under the umbrella of member services. There's also a couple of things you might not think about. The ACS has an archive, so that's in member services as well.
Thank you. And for those people who may not be aware of the size and scope of the ACS, perhaps you could just outline in rough numbers domestic fellows versus overseas and the number of countries in which we have chapters and active participation.
So we have about 83,000 members in the ACS, and that includes all of the groups from medical students up to and through retirement. So we really do represent the organization to which you can belong across your entire career of surgery. We have probably about 80% of our members are within the US and Canada, and the other 20% are from other countries around the world. And we have representation in nearly every country. We don't have chapters in every country, so we have about 40 domestic chapters and about 35 international chapters. But we have fellows and members in more countries than we have chapters.
Thank you. Now, to switch gears and talk about the COVID-19 pandemic, you very rapidly responded and realized that one of the major areas that needed to be addressed was wellness. So we hear in the news and we read about patient wellness, and you can't look at any website or open any periodical, listen to any broadcast that doesn't talk about the patients and their health. But you quite rightly realize that there needs to be a focus on provider health too, and provider physical and mental health. If we're to continue to care for patients, we need to care for ourselves. If you could please perhaps outline some of the resources that you've made available to fellows and members through membership services.
Well, unfortunately, as we know, physicians in general and surgeons in particular are already at higher risk compared to the general public when it relates to issues around burnout and depression. And that's unfortunate, but really there are a number of things that we know that feed into that. And so the ACS has really considered well-being an integral part of what we do to support our members since well before COVID-19. We have resources and we try to be mindful of the things that impact our well-being as physicians and as surgeons. With the COVID-19 pandemic, it actually has exacerbated the problems that we know can exist. And so the ACS has wanted to respond to that. For example, we know that healthcare workers on the front lines caring for these COVID-19 patients feel an even outsized sense of stress, because the patients are novel, they have new problems, we don't really have an algorithm to follow, and that can be kind of stressful for us as healthcare providers. In addition, there is a whole notion of infectious risk to other patients and to our families. So individuals who are on the front lines providing care for patients are now not only worried about are they themselves at risk personally, but are they themselves at risk and then therefore at risk of infecting another patient or taking the COVID 19 infection home to their families. So it's a multifactorial issue. There's the other side of it as well, which is individuals who may not be on the front lines are being asked to stay home, which we know is safe and the right thing to do. But it does disrupt our normal process of interacting with others. And there's a component of this anxiety that may come from not having the typical outlets that we have to interact with friends and family and, you know, be outside or exercise or the things that we would typically do. So in response to all of that, the ACS has put together on part of our website, there's a well-being section. There is a well-being index. So this is a validated tool developed in conjunction with surgeons at the Mayo Institute. And that allows any individual to go in and take a quick test and find out where they are along this continuum of well-being and burnout. And you can do it multiple times. So you may be particularly stressed today and be much better tomorrow. And there's one that's validated for attendings and one that's validated for trainees as well. And then there are resources to help you improve your resilience or your well-being or beat back the anxiety or depression that may exist. And there's papers in the peer-reviewed literature, there are blogs, there are webinars, both related to COVID-19 and not related to COVID-19.
Thank you. Perhaps you might be able to outline a couple of specifics. There are things that we sort of generically hear about, service that offers meditation on an app, is it doing so for free, yoga, exercise classes by video. I mean, what are some of the things that you'd recommend that people do to help relieve stress and improve mental well-being?
Well, physical activity is a big thing. For those individuals who are typically really active, being inside and not being able to, for example, go to the gym or having to limit their time outside running or biking or whatever they might enjoy doing is can be really stressful. And for those who are a little bit more like the couch potatoes, it actually is still good to get some physical activity. So one of the things that you can do certainly is you can still be outside if you have the opportunity to be, you know, in a park or where you're not going to be around other people. And so physical activity outside is still acceptable. Wear a mask, of course. And maintain your, you know, 6 to 10 foot distance from any other individuals, but that's still acceptable. If you have a backyard or, you know, a balcony or something that allows you to get some fresh air, we do know that that is important. And so just getting outside of literally the four walls of your home can improve your well-being. And you can do, you know, jumping jacks or, you know, jump rope or do things that get your heart rate up, even inside your own home. So stand by a window if you have to. We know that interaction with other individuals is an important part of what makes us feel whole and connected. So whether or not it's a Zoom happy hour with friends that you would typically see in real life, whether it is interaction over the phone or even sending text messages back and forth, particularly with other healthcare providers. People who are able to empathize with you. I think our loved ones and family who may not be physicians can sympathize, but having someone who actually understands the patient dilemmas as it relates to ethical choices we're having to make that are pretty extraordinary these days, whether it relates to a bad outcome that might have occurred, whether it relates to stresses of healthcare worker colleagues who may be ill. So all of those conversations, having them out loud and being able to have a sounding board can be helpful. There are some apps, as you mentioned, some of them are being made available free for healthcare workers right now that help you with meditation. Some people have a meditative practice that they've been doing for a long time. But if you don't know how to do that or haven't tried it, now is a good time to try one of those apps. They're available, you know, in the app store and online even. And really spend a couple of minutes every day in meditation. The final thing I'll say is that there are webinars and the ACS does have contact information on the website for mental health support. So if you are feeling isolated, if you are feeling depressed, if you do need someone to talk to, we have provided some 1-800 numbers, some websites where you can reach out to professionals who can support you through that.
Excellent, excellent advice. One of the campaigns on which the ACS embarked was physical distancing, and I think you just touched on it, the importance to maintain socialization and social distancing is really a misnomer. What we're trying to achieve is physical distancing rather than social distancing. So the idea of the happy hour webinars or Zooms or whatever seems to be a very good method. A lot of good information going forward. Eventually, we hope soon, we hope even more, we're going to have the bulk of this pandemic behind us. It may leave some indelible changes in the way we live, just as happened with 9/11, or perhaps with AIDS and universal precautions, changes in healthcare, changes in the world. What's your advice for us going forward in terms of surgeon and healthcare professional wellness as we get on the other side of the pandemic?
Well, I think a lot is going to change. I think we would all agree that we have learned how to do work in ways that are different than ways that we traditionally did work. I think some people were already on the cutting edge of using technology to get their work done, and now everyone has had to very rapidly get up to speed. So while we'll never get rid of the interaction that's face-to-face that we all enjoy so much, I do think that there is going to be a place going forward for video conferences, webinars, just like we're doing right now, that may not require us to get on a plane and fly across the country for a 2 or 3 hour lecture, which I think all of us have experienced. Or there is a meeting that's critically important and your input is necessary, and no one wants to be that disembodied voice on the telephone. But if it were able to be done with a video conference so you can see facial expressions and you can sense what individuals are thinking and doing from the nonverbal cues, that can be done pretty effectively via a webinar. So I think this will be part of what is integrated into our practice now as a more regular component. There's never going to be a replacement for face-to-face meetings. Those are always great. The networking, going to the clinical congress, for example, and you know, having 12,000 or 13,000 surgical colleagues in one city, you can't replace that. And that will always be a part of what we do. But we also want to be mindful of the fact that right now our surgeon members are going to be experiencing fallout from COVID-19 for a year or 2 years to come. In the fall, for example, there may be a second wave. We've talked about that. What is going to happen if there's a resurgence of the coronavirus superimposed on the traditional flu? What about cases that we've had to postpone, rightfully so, elective cases that could not be done because we were trying to flatten the curve? But those patients still have to be managed. And so the fall may bring an even busier time for many of our practicing surgeons. And so the impact on our practices, whether it's financial or clinical or emotional, will continue to be part of what we do for the next however many numbers of months to years. And so that's going to change our ability to jump on a plane and go to a meeting. It's going to change our ability to spend a week away from our practice at even the most well-intentioned and well-thought-through meeting. So we may need to have a little bit of a mix of face-to-face and real-time and technology and innovation that allows us to reap the rewards without taking time away from our practice, our research, our families, or whatever's happening at home. One other thing I'd like to mention is that the sheltering at home, the staying inside, can have another untoward effect on health that we haven't talked about. And that's the increased risk of intimate partner violence. We do know that intimate partner violence can impact anyone. It can impact both genders, it can impact all ages, it can impact people of any socioeconomic status, any education level. And for some people, we have to remember going to work and getting out of the house is a respite and is a time away from their abuser. So in situations where emotions are already high, where stress is already high, and where we're telling people, rightfully so, that they should stay home, we also need to be mindful that the risk of intimate partner violence does increase and has increased. And we've seen that during the COVID-19 epidemic. So also on the ACS webpage are some specific resources from our intimate partner violence work group that address the needs of those survivors.
Well, thank you very much for your wisdom and your insights for COVID-19. And thank you for all that you do for the ACS, for all of us surgeons throughout the world, every day of every year. It's a pleasure working with you and benefiting from your energy and inspirational leadership. I wish you and your family sustained health and safety during this pandemic, and do look forward to seeing you in person at some point in the hopefully not too distant future.
That would be great. Thanks so much for having this conversation with me. And I look forward to seeing you again at a next meeting.